that it? I think that's it. I think it's focus now. The autofocus, the little sensor, it likes eyes and teeth. So yeah, I think that got it. So because the current project I'm doing is taking so long, if you don't want spoilers, look away now. So this is like some of what I'm working on the table. Spoilers over now. I've decided to take a little break and do a little different video. And normally I would do a charity micro build, but I noticed something the other day, like that was like directly in front of me the entire time. And I was like, oh, we can do a charity macro, maybe not quite a build, but like a sprucing up, a restoration. Cause this guy, this giant axe, has been lying here since about 2015. And it's been various parts outside the workshop. And I reckon we could spruce it up, maybe set it for charity. And then that would give me a little bit of a break from doing the complex stuff. Normally I wouldn't be able to justify taking a little break like this. But this video's got a sponsor. It's sponsored by NordVPN. But what is NordVPN? And why would you want it? Let's say the year is 2011 and you follow this Irish idiot sword maker guy on YouTube. And you see that he's uploaded a new video, but because the guy is an idiot and he hasn't decided whether or not he's doing this as a hobby or professionally, and he doesn't understand the rules about music usage, when you click the video, you see that you can't actually watch it because you live in the wrong country. Or let's say you're an Irish guy living in America and your ma sends you a link to the Irish Christmas toy show because that's an essential part of an Irish Christmas and you want to show it to your own kids, so you click the link only to discover that you can't watch it because you're in America. These are the types of things that NordVPN can help you out with, because a VPN bounces your signal such that you can view the internet as if you're in any country of your choosing. It even works in China. And even works on sites like Netflix and such. If you don't like it, it comes with a 30-day money-back guarantee. And if the coronavirus ever goes back to normal, it can protect your data while you're in airports and cafes and other places from the before time and the long, long ago. It has a cybersec security suite which acts as an ad blocker and doesn't do any data logging. It has live 24-hour customer support and up to 6 simultaneous connections. NordVPN has double data encryption for enhanced anonymity. Double's gotta be at least twice as good as regular anonymity. So to get 68% off NordVPN, that's just $3.71 per month and an additional month free, head on over to nordvpn.com/Michael Cthulhu or use the coupon code Michael Cthulhu at checkout. I knew this was in here. I have to go digging to find it though. This is a half-inch plate of Hardox. So one of the things, oh my god, I was never quite happy with this blade, was the shape of the edge. We had to work with what we found in that junkyard. But I always felt like there should be more here. With this big piece of Hardox, I'm wondering, can I give it like a meaty half-inch thick blade? Put a line this away anyway, and then we do a big slope like this. We can get into this, but I'll probably weld the back on with a shallow curve. Any inclination it had to twist or bend is made even more difficult. So basically, yeah, this outline in the chalk is one I want to cut out. It looks like a crazy bird now. Oh wow, that's crazy. The curve I drew lines up with this old shadow. I don't know, can you hear it, see it? I think those are the handles off the Zeus blade I made. But the curve, it goes wonky here. But this, look how that lines up. Just needs the tiniest bit, just something a little bit shallow. Because a little curve or a bend just exponentially increases the amount of force it would need to wrench itself off. So the reason I'm doing this with the discs is to preserve the temper. It would be much faster to just take the torch and go, but then that would defeat the point of using the Hardox. So as it is, the grinding, I'm sure, does something, but you're trying to preserve it. I have to use the plasma cutter now on these corners, but my technique is you blast in from like here or someplace that's far enough away from where the edge actually has to be, and then go whee, blip, and that way this side gets the plasma heat, but it can't jump through the air gap. So you can see here, it got a little close, this bit's blue, but luckily you can see where the white line is in relationship to the blue. But I think the rest, we've got some yellow going on there. But the rest, I think, focus. Some more yellow there. The rest of it's pretty good. The back of it, I could just cut off with the torch, because I don't think the heat, I don't know how much it is using things better than your eyes, but when you do the torch, the heat zone is like a half inch. So I'll just use the regular torch on this back half. The camera ran out of battery just as I was finishing up. But that's the thing. It looks a little bit wibbly wobbly because I guess the chalk line was wibbly wobbly. But now that I have rough cut out both sides, I can start in with the angle grinder with the big mop disc. Kyle over at KO Creations gave me this big disc. So, thanks Kyle. It's going towards a charity thing. That is some serious rain for having weeks of not a peep of it. I'll get this stuff inside. The rain settled down a bit. I was going to set up the vinegar bath for that piece. Then I remembered it had a bunch of other stuff. Ew, this isn't even a thing. It's, oh, gross. I'm going to set up the vinegar bath for it, but I forgot I had a bunch of other stuff in here. Old stuff from a yard sale that was all seized up. Well, that worked. And the second team fortress. Oh yeah. That worked great compared to how it was before. This was completely seized up. These two things were the worst. Like, these were just garbage before. Should get the air in those before the water starts making them rust.
There it is. Rainbow.
Rainbow? My eyes. Oh, there it is. Yeah, I see it. Focus can't hack this at all. So a thing I want to do here as part of sprucing this guy up is this fire cage was always a bit of a hassle to access, so I want to make this guy into a trap door. So the idea is this: you load up this guy with rags and then light her up, and then you have this like burning exhaust thing on the back of the axe, but you have previously you had to shove the rags down the back here, or in here, it's a pain in the butt. So, trapdoor for easy conflagration. I don't know what you'd call it, but anyway. Okay. The back of it still has gunk in it. So, gotta open this guy up. Decided to use the plasma cutter, because I think it will look, even if I do crazy wonky lines, I think it'll look more interesting than the angle grinder lines. There we go. Ooh. I need both hands. I need a way to hold this on here. I don't know. Hang on, I'm gonna figure this out. Too hot to touch. That's the fire cage. Much easier to get at now. Hot, hot, hot. Where's the thing gun? Can I do this one-handed? Probably not. Oh, maybe. People often make fun of me for having grinders on the floor, but if you're dealing with a cable mess, like if you're trying to clean up your cables, your angle grinders can't fall to the floor if they're already on the floor. So that's a lot of the time. If I notice my cables are getting too wacky, I'll often put the grinders on the floor till I get a chance to clean them up. Ooh. What's this? Oh, I remember this. This was a little hammerhead thing that I found that was all rusty. It needs longer in there because it was very rusted, but you can see part of it's coming back. Let's see this guy. Did that work? I think it did, but the water's so cloudy. I'll get it out and hose it off. That's still bright red. Will that come off? I often hear people in my videos talk about the rust, but this red stuff on the Hardox isn't rust. It's a kind of the scale combined with a weird epoxy stuff they put on it to stop rusting. So the orange color, and I'm sure they make it orange so that if there's a disruption of the surface and it does start to rust, it doesn't look too silly. But yeah, the orange baseline coating of the Hardox is not rust. But the vinegar still dissolves it. Presumably because it soaks through to the scale level below. I wish you could buy Hardox with just the scale level. It might look cool in some applications to have a grey coloured Hardox. Because I'm making this up as I go along. Pity there's nothing here, but I might weld in a section. Because I think this would actually look better if it was further out. Now for this guy, what would it look like if we just did this? That wouldn't look too bad. Yeah, I think that'll do. We just gotta fill in this part with some half inch scrap that's lying around. Oh yeah. I don't know, was it the rust, but yeah, that cut much messier than the half inch Hardox, even though I'm pretty sure this stuff is only quarter inch. I think this piece is from doing the He-Man sword. Weird. This stuff cut much better than that other stuff. It must have just been the angle I was standing at, because this is rusty half inch. And this stuff also cut pretty smooth. So this gap here is a little bit bigger than I'd like it to be. But I think that works. Weld those in. I was debating whether I was going to sandblast this or not. And I think it'll look weird. Like it would take a lot of work. And a lot of this thing's charm is in a lot of the rusty textures on its surface. And I think an imperfect sandblasting job would not look great. It would either have to be like totally done. Yeah, I don't think it would be good. So I'm gonna wire brush this surface. But before I do that, I wanna weld this guy on. I'm gonna wire brush it. It'll take some of the loose rust off, reduce it to actually more of a kind of a this color. One more thing I wanted to do with the handle maybe. That involves the sandblaster. I couldn't do a full run because I had chopped off some of the sharpened edge to get this wedge in there, but because this was some of the sharpened edge, the material was kind of thin, so I had to build it up that way. I'm gonna flip it and weld the other side before doing the next bit. 23. Bet you this stuff's gonna be 2 inches. More or less 2 inches. Cruelty of cruelties. I was going up this thing and I had almost enough to get to the end. The only one I had left to do was in here. Boop, boop. And that's when I ran out of tape. I'll have to see, do I have another roll of the black Gorilla tape lying around somewhere. Should I have my groovy thing for... I needed to access 360 degrees of it, so I needed a way to get this big boy freestanding. So I was masking this guy off just to get at those bits. And I was moving the thing from here to over here, and the spike up there hit one of my lights. Ah! And so now the floor is covered in bits of fluorescent tube. Now, thankfully, I had swept the floor relatively recently, so it's not mingled in with a bunch of tools and stuff. I wonder, am I covered in any little bits of glass? I don't know. I can't see. Mercury vapor lamp dust. So, I mean, this has been seen in other videos. I have this set up in here, lights up there, some tarps, and so I'm going to just attempt to sandblast all of these exposed squares without sandblasting the rest of it. I plasma cut out this guy because I thought these areas might be a little bit cantankerous. And so the real question is, can I sandblast? Where would I put the camera? Can I sandblast? Do I really have to go find a shirt? Or can I get away with doing this with just the hood on? I wasn't too bad, actually. My nipples feel like they might be even pinker than they were before. But even doing it like that, I was sweating a lot in that horrible tent. Yeah, it's not so bad doing a bare chest. There's one or more two sticky things left. A thing I discovered about the Gorilla Tape. WD-40 dissolves the Gorilla Tape stuff. Normally, if it was bare steel, I'd use acetone. But obviously, I can't use acetone on the paint. But yeah, WD-40, if you ever have to take duct tape sticky stuff off a surface and you don't want to use any kind of solvent, WD-40 will take it off as well. So I didn't expect that back part to get so shiny so fast. As soon as stuff's burning in here, that'll all blacken again. But yeah, see what I mean about like leaving the rust, but just taking off the loose stuff, leaving the character it has. Gotta do that to the tail as well. This one is so pitted. I can't even begin to imagine how you could artificially create this kind of look. Whew. So this guy is a half inch. So that means I would normally make the blade an inch deep. And that is what I'm gonna do now. But I gotta remember which one of these holes is. Is it that guy all the way out on the edge? Hang on. I mean, it makes sense. It's the biggest blade I would normally do. Yeah, that's the inch hole. And this is my gadget. I don't know when the last time it appeared in my videos was. It's good for marking edge curve like this. It's a simple little thing, but if you're struggling like I used to do, with marking out curved edges. Can be handy. I'm gonna try using the mop disc, or flap disc is what they're called over here. And, because they remove a lot of material fast. The only thing is they sometimes leave blurry edges, so see how it goes. I've done this before on other blades. Should be fine. So now that's down to a quarter, I've just, the difference between this surface and that edge, am I describing this properly? I just have to take off the difference between this surface, and that's that edge sharpened. Do the other half tonight, because apparently there's people bugging me to come in for dinner time. The soot operates as an anti-spatter. I mean, I'm not sure that it's as good as like something in a bottle, but unlike a lot of my experience with the stuff in a bottle, is you can just wipe it off with your finger. A lot of the stuff I have experienced with leaves very greasy, greasy stuff. Oh wow, there's little bits of weird soot demons floating around near the camera. Stuck to the viewfinder and such. This big gap here, it will fuse to the plate if I try to fill it. I'm gonna have to add in extra material. That might be one of the longest MIG welds I've done in years. That's side number two welded. Something that annoyed me about the previous one is when you left it down on a surface, the weight came on the previous sharp edge was back here, but the new, I don't want to put the weight on the actual tip here like this, because it'll either make garbage of the floor or it'll make garbage of the tip if it's hard enough. So if we weld in just like a little piece here, like this. Beep. It stops it doing that. So that's the very last part of this, I promise. My eternal problem of clamps and things getting in the way. Flip it over and do the other side. I drilled a hole here because I thought it would make it look more interesting. Now, just double check I didn't mess up completely. Yeah, that keeps it off the floor. This may be the first time I've ever squirted this guy with WD-40. Makes it look a lot darker. It's not bad, it's just weird. 70 pound. Actually, I should get the weighing scales. See what weight this guy actually is. I have the weighing scales. What weight am I on all the gear? $212. Ooh! Can I do this? $292. So, is that 80 pounds? What was that first number I said? 212. 80 pounds. Oh boy!
This is testing out the fire cage, fire basket, I don't know what you'd call it. I mean, it's not so much testing out, because that implies you're wondering, would it fail? And I don't know, as low-tech items go, this is about as low-tech as you could possibly get. So, but I didn't have to spend 10, 15 minutes trying to shove a old t-shirt in here with a, stick, so that's different. Swing this a little bit out from the table. This guy's closed again. The burning cloth goes for quite a while in my experience. Cloth soaked in accelerant. Reinventing the wick.
Oh my god. Whoa. Heavy thing. So, as I said at the top of the video, this is a charity auction item. If you feel like making the world a little bit less awful, send me an email. There'll be details in the video description. I know things are kind of a little bit rough at the moment with the coronavirus and all that, but if you're feeling it at the top of the pile, can you imagine what it's like at the bottom of the pile? The only thing I would say is this guy is 80 pounds and 7 foot whatever, maybe 7 foot long. So if you're ordering it from outside the States, I normally say that I'll cover the first $200 of shipping for all these charity items. And that's normally well more than enough. But if you're outside the States, this guy could cost well more than $200 to ship, so just be aware of that when you send me an email. We can sort it out when you send me an email. That's it. I am so hot and sweaty and tired.